Welcome back to the second part of this hemodynamics series. Next, we're going to talk about terminology, because understanding what it is that you're talking about when we're throwing around all these terms and how it relates to what we're looking at with the patient is important. And yeah, it's great if you can diagnose aortic stenosis from just a list of pressures, but do you actually understand how that is affecting everything else? Because sometimes someone will come with a scenario and go, oh, I know that because that LV pressure is high, there must be something wrong with either the LV or kind of what's after it, but I don't really know what it's called, is really valuable. And then when you layer the terminology and the diagnosis on top of that, you start connecting all of those dots. But really understanding the why is more important. So the first thing is what we've been talking about all along, which is hemodynamics. Hemodynamics is how blood flows through the heart. So hemo is related to the word heme, and heme, if you don't know, is blood. And dynamics is movement. So this is the movement of blood through the heart, and it's related to a few different things. So let's write that. Movement of blood . So this could be affected by an increase in flow, a decrease in flow, maybe even the stopping of flow or the impeding of flow. And that is really what you would see from the example I talked about first, like aortic stenosis. Or even coarctation, so like aortic stenosis, this is the left ventricle, okay, this is the aorta, and you have the valve here. So if you have an issue, let's do this, from the blood moving from here to here because of this valve, well, what would happen to the pressure before it? It would increase because it can't move forward, so then the pressure after it would decrease. So that altogether is a hemodynamic phenomenon. So hemodynamics is really the umbrella term of everything that we're going to talk about. And then you have subcategories under that and terminology that's layered in, like we just talked about, right? Increase in pressure, you might hear hypertension or hypotension. All of those are subcategories under this. So the first one that we are actually going to talk about is preload. Pre meaning before, and we can just skip ahead here, and afterload meaning after. So what you're going to notice is a lot of what we talk about with hemodynamics is in relation to the left ventricle or the right ventricle. So preload for the left ventricle would be what comes before the left ventricle, and then afterload would be what the left ventricle has to push against what comes after it. So preload is directly related to ventricular filling. And that's a very basic way and a simple way of saying it. But again, we're talking about simple here to try to remember those terms. So preload is related to ventricular filling. And the actual definition of this is the amount of ventricular stretching that occurs. Because when the ventricle fills with blood from somewhere, right, it has to stretch and kind of open to accommodate that, like a water balloon. So I will put the proper thing here for you. And that will encompass, you know, stretch, elasticity, force, compliance, and that can be read as a pressure. Now, preload is related to a few different things. Besides ventricular filling, some things that can really affect that could be contractility. So the ability really for the heart to contract. Compliance. Remember, in this case, we're really talking about the ventricles, pressure, heart rate, and the amount of venous return, because you need blood to move blood. So if you say they have an increased in preload or they're really depleted in preload, there's usually an underlying issue for that. And that's where you kind of look at these other scenarios and these other factors that might be related to some things like, you know, compliance and contractility and the rest of that. The next one we're going to talk about is afterload, which I guess you could say is the opposite of preload. Preload is for filling, and afterload is about ventricular contraction. Specifically, this is going to be about how much resistance the ventricle has to overcome. So let's start with that. How much resistance? So you might hear about like PVR and SVR, pulmonary vascular resistance, systemic vascular resistance, has to overcome in order to keep the forward flow of blood. Because your body, remember, like homeostasis, it wants to keep kind of the status quo and the normal. So normally blood goes from, for instance, the left ventricle to the aorta. You could flip this and say RV and PA as well. So how much does the left ventricle have to overcome a force and resistance that's in the aorta to keep blood moving from the left ventricle into the aorta instead of it coming back this way and pooling, or even worse, going kind of back into the left atrium? It wants majority of this to move this way so that it can go to the body. And I'll show you visually what that looks like at the end. My last little tip, if you want to think of it this way, is that preload is pre-ventricle and afterload is post-ventricle. So when hemodynamically we look at numbers and formulas, we're going to think about what chambers come before and after the ventricle that affect preload and afterload. The next one we've gone over in my first video, but pressure gradient, which is the difference in pressures really where they should not be. A difference in pressures, and I guess you could say an abnormal difference in pressure. And that's where we've talked about aortic stenosis and that systolic difference in pressures. Okay, so for instance, let's write AO and LV. So if AO is 120, 80, 93, and LV is 120, 0, 9, what would a pressure gradient look like? So right now, let's change this to blue. All right, so right now, both of these systolic pressures are the same. They're equal to each other. Okay, 120 equals 120. There is no gradient there. But in the presence of aortic stenosis, like we talked about way up here, if it can't move forward, then this pressure is going to increase. So if my LV pressure is higher, let's just change this to 220 to be dramatic. What is my new pressure gradient? Is there a gradient? Yes, 220 minus 120 is 100 millimeters of mercury. So you have 100 millimeter of mercury peak to peak or systolic gradient. So now we've used some of these terms when we looked at that example, but systole is what we talked about. These were systolic numbers. So what is systole? Well, systole is contraction. And remember, what are we talking about in relation to the ventricle? And then diastole is relaxation. So during diastole, filling is occurring, and during systole, ejection of blood is occurring. And again, that's in relation to the ventricles. Next, we're going to talk about hypertrophy and dilation, which are really consequences of some of the elevated pressure scenarios that we talked about kind of earlier in here, and you'll hear about when we talk about some of the different comorbidities that can go on with a patient. So hypertrophy really means an increase in muscle mass. So let's write that first. Now, where is the muscle layer in the heart? The myocardium, which is located where? The ventricles. Okay, so in the left ventricle, you will have an endocardium, a myocardium, which is the muscle layer, and then the epicardium, which is on the outside. So the muscle layer is really what we are interested in here when we're talking about hypertrophy. You might have heard about hypertrophy, like if you lift weights or you work out, you'll talk about the hypertrophy of your muscle, right? So why would you have that increase in muscle mass, right? Just like when you're working out and you're building muscle, it's because you kind of increase that resistance, that pressure, and that workload on that muscle group. So if that increase in pressure happens in the chamber, like in the left ventricle, okay, why would that happen? it could increase from an increase in pressure, right? So you have this increase of pressure in the left ventricle, maybe from that aortic stenosis we talked about earlier, and it's trying really hard to keep that forward flow. So if it's meeting this resistance in front of it, it's gonna buff up to really try to push all of that forward, and that's why you might see a hypertrophic left ventricle. The same could be said if you have like systemic hypertension, you have really high blood pressure in the aorta and the peripheral arterial vessels. Same thing, that always comes back to the left ventricle that's trying to push against that. So you're gonna start to see that hypertrophy. The second situation is, what if it can't? What if instead we retain volume because we're not strong enough to build up that muscle and we just give up? That is where you start to see dilation. Now, a chamber that doesn't have that myocardium is, is the atrium, right? So here's the atrium, here's the ventricle. So the ventricle had that myocardium, but the atrium really doesn't. It's very compliant. It works really, really well to a fault with volume. So if it's retaining a lot of volume, the atrium's gonna kind of stretch and be like, oh yeah, I can accommodate all of that volume, which is why sometimes you'll see really severe left atrial dilation from mitral regurgitation, because it does accommodate it and just kind of stretches out, and you start to get that pooling of blood and that retainment of blood. So we're gonna call dilation the expansion of a chamber or cavity. Now, does the left ventricle have the ability to dilate? Absolutely. Have you heard of cardiomyopathy, of a dilated cardiomyopathy? And that's what it is, the dilation and the expansion of that left ventricular chamber from a disease of the myocardium. So when you get that increase in volume, like a water balloon filling up, you're gonna get that dilation of the chamber cavity. So let's take a look at what this looks like visually. Where we are gonna start is in the SVC, the superior vena cava, and the IVC, the inferior vena cava. So what that does is it brings blood, so the SVC, from the upper body, make this a little bigger, from the upper body into the right atrium, and then the IVC brings deoxygenated blood from the lower body, the lower half of the body, into the right atrium. So then what you're gonna see is that all of this blood moves and goes through the tricuspid valve, which is on the right side of the heart, into the right ventricle, and then from the right ventricle through the pulmonic valve and into the pulmonary artery. The pulmonary artery takes all of that blood to go to the lungs to get oxygenated. And then that oxygenated blood comes through the pulmonary veins and into the left atrium. So really one of the highest points of oxygen saturation that you're gonna find is actually in the pulmonary veins, because it comes right after the lungs. Then it will go through the mitral valve and into the left ventricle. And from the left ventricle, it will push all of that blood out into the aorta. And that is how you get perfusion to the body, to the coronary arteries, which are kind of right here, and to the brain. So let's talk about our first problem, because when we give scenarios of different issues that the patient has, what you need to step back and look at is, how is it affecting each of these chambers, and am I seeing that reflected in their pressures? So the first problem we're going to have is in the tricuspid valve. So let's say the tricuspid valve is diseased. I'll do this in green. So the tricuspid valve is diseased. Specifically, let's say there's an obstruction in the door, right? So the blood can't get into the right ventricle. Let's just say tricuspid stenosis. Very rare, but regardless, it's a really good example. So you can go ahead and take away all of the other blood flow, because if it can't get into the right ventricle, it can't get into the lungs, right? So what you're gonna see is all of this blood in the right atrium kind of stays here. So you're gonna have an increase in volume and therefore an increase in pressure in the right atrium. It can't really get through. You're probably gonna have some get through, but you might have some of this reduced pressure in the right ventricle because the reduced volume. And then that will show reduced pressure where? In the pulmonary artery, and then you're getting a reduction in deoxygenated blood to the lungs, so it's less blood for the lungs to oxygenate. So then you're going to reduce how much oxygenated blood gets to the rest of the body, right? Because it has to come in here and so on and so forth. So the end result, you might see, I'm very dramatic, but maybe like altered mental status, because the brain isn't getting a lot of oxygenated blood. You're having these lower lower saturations, you're just not super sure why. Well, if you understand hemodynamics, you can kind of trace that all the way back to this one valvular issue. And the point of that is so that you really pinpoint the underlying cause so that it is treated properly. Instead of how it affects everything after it, what if we had the tricuspid valve issue? How does it affect everything before it? So we're actually going to have this increase of pressure in the right atrium, right? But what comes before the right atrium? The SVC and the IVC, and where do those go again? The upper extremities and the lower extremities. So I might see maybe positive JVD because I'm having some of that venous retention, or maybe even edema, right? Peripheral edema. And again, that comes from this underlying issue. So instead of treating all of the other symptoms that come from this one issue, if we, let's say, replaced this tricuspid valve, would it then relieve all of these other issues and symptoms that we are seeing? So let's give another one. One that is a lot more common. What if we had an aortic valve issue? Okay, and we've talked about this a little bit because it's so common, it's really good to practice over and over again. If there's a bunch of volume, though, let's say this is aortic stenosis, okay? So it's an outflow problem. The blood can't get out of the left ventricle really effectively. If there's a bunch of volume in the left ventricle that can't move, you're gonna have this increase in pressure in the left ventricle. Same idea that we kind of talked about before, but with the right atrium, right? If it can't move forward, then that's where it kind of stays. So then we talked about this. What is the left ventricle gonna do to try and get that blood out? Buff up a little bit, right? So you might have some LV hypertrophy. Again, increased pressures there, but maybe it'll still get out some of that volume. But that only lasts for so long. So eventually that muscle is no longer strong enough to keep forward flow if this is a chronic issue. And instead of hypertrophy, we might now migrate to, left ventricular dilation, right? So let's talk that dilated cardiomyopathy. Instead of hypertrophy, now you're going to see this enlarged chamber. You might still have increased pressure, but it's now from a volume issue. So now what you're going to see is that LV cavity can get really thin and really large, like many of your heart failure patients. So that's how the hemodynamics eventually affects every chamber in the heart and why it's so important. Because when you start to see this dilation, right, you have increased LVEDP, right? So let's say left-sided heart failure. That blood, if it can't move forward, is going to back up into the left atrium. So you have an increase in pressure here. There's no valve here. So it can back up into the lungs. You can see that as pulmonary congestion, right? Your lungs are not super happy with that. And then that can cause increase in pulmonary vascular resistance, which can increase your PA pressure. That can lead to now the RV having this issue and keeping forward flow, right-sided heart failure. And again, dramatic issue, but your congestive heart failure patients, this is kind of what you're looking at, is they might have had one or two initial issues that just went undiagnosed and untreated and has now exacerbated itself into this kind of perfect storm. I hope that helps. Thank you so much for watching part 2, all about terminology with hemodynamics, and stay tuned for the next video.